being an ally is not a lifelong title. So it is something that you have to constantly work at. I mean, you know, just like professional designations, you become an accountant or you become an insurance professional, you still have to complete professional continuing credits to keep your title alive and to keep your, you know, your designation active. And allyship is just like that.
Welcome to ABCDEI, a podcast that explores topics of diversity, equity, and inclusion through stories of distinct and powerful lived experiences.
If you are tired of the preaching, shaming, and theory about why inclusion matters and just want to create change already, then you're in the right place.
Join us as we unlearn bias one alphabet at a time. My name is Susan Diaz.
And I'm Rohini Mukherjee.
Hi, and welcome back to ABCDEI. Today, we're going to take a little bit of a departure from normal programming. And so Susan and I thought that we would respond to a question that we've got from a few different people, which is, okay, I get it. I love it. I'm inspired by your guests. I like what you're doing. But how do I incorporate it into my practice? How do I incorporate it into my daily habits? How do I incorporate it into the way I raise my kids or run a workplace? And so we are going to create a bit of a primer for allyship.
What we think are two key practices that we think are the cornerstone practices for your inclusion way.
How do you get your mindset shifted into being more inclusive and into being more of an ally?
Approaching inclusion and actions from the metaphor of baking.
We are going to put a focus on what allyship is not. That's always a great way to build towards a goal by clarifying what it's not, right, Susan?
Correct. Completely.
We started this passion project really with the firm belief that we know some things. We don't know all the things, but we know some things. And sometimes starting from a place of humor and humility is the way to go. So this might be a little bit of a, you know, if you thought you were on the way to allyship, this might be a bit of a stop in your tracks and bad news episode, but we promise we will get you there. So we're going to focus on five things that allyship is not. The first one, and probably the most important one, it is not self-appointed. Do not go around saying, I am an ally, because nobody has bestowed that on you. You can't bestow that on yourself, rather. It has to be something that you earn. It's not a monopoly board. You don't collect 89 weak points and then ding, 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 make it to destination. It is something that you have to earn and work hard at.
Yeah, 100%. You have to earn the right for someone to call you an ally. And I think that's pretty important to remember. So even just start there, you know, don't just sort of give yourself those woke points and say, I'm all set, I'm the greatest ally. You have to get into action. The second of them is that allyship is not a box to check. It's not one of those things where you get into it from a defensive stance and you're like, I'm not a racist, I'm an ally. And like, let me do just the minimum possible in order to be seen as an ally. Like read a couple books and, you know, comment on a few people's black squares on Instagram. That's a box checking exercise. That's a way for you to insulate yourself from the real situation and feel better, but it really doesn't help anyone. And this is the reason why some activists get annoyed when various people sort of jump on bandwagons, like, for example, for Pride in June, when everyone's like, oh, here's a logo with my rainbow slapped on it. You know, that kind of box checking, that's not allyship. So we should probably think about staying away from those.
Yeah, and I think the other part of that is you can be, you know, not a racist, and there's such a long journey between that and allyship, right? So, I mean, both of those can be true. You can be committed to being an ally and doing the work, but not being a racist is just sort of step one or two. You really have to go towards building being an anti-racist. The other part of it too is being an ally is not a lifelong title. So it is something that you have to constantly work at. I mean, you know, just like professional designations, you become an accountant or you become an insurance professional, you still have to complete professional continuing credits to keep your title alive and to keep your, you know, your designation active. And allyship is just like that. You know, you could be, you could absolutely work towards, do the work towards being an ally in your workplace. But as needs and as, you know, people evolve, that requires some upgrading. So it isn't something that you just have, well, you know, it's not a one time for life.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not a lifetime membership software that you got on beta a few years ago. So in continuation to that, which is point three, then is point four, which is allyship is not one size fits all. Just because you're not a racist doesn't mean you're, you know, you're also not a bigot in any other way. And I'm any one of us, in like you said, when we started this journey, we started it saying there's so much that we have to learn and so much that we have to unlearn ourselves. So nobody has the title of being ally to all. So just because you're an ally to one cause, one ideology, and one philosophy doesn't automatically sort of make you a one size fits all. It's like, of course I'm great. My girlfriend's black, so I know everything about being gay as well. Like, that's not how it goes. And really respecting the differences between sort of different people, regardless of what it is. I think that's the fourth point to remember what allyship is not.
Yeah. And because we like fives, the fifth one is there's no badge for it. There's no cute sticker you can put on your Twitter profile. There isn't, you know, something that you can add as a LinkedIn, you know, title that people can recommend you to. It's not a skill. It really is that, you know, thinking about inclusion all the time. That's how you build towards allyship. But really, it isn't a badge. And it isn't a one-time achievement or a diploma or, you know, a framed certificate on your wall.
We really want to dig into what we think are two key practices. As with anything else, whether it's a physiological or a mental health practice, it takes effort, it takes commitment, it takes consistently showing up, doing it, and that's how you get there. So these two that we will break down are the practices that we think are the cornerstone practices for your inclusion way.
So yes, I mean, just as, you know, if you were starting any new routine or any new chapter of your life, you know, you'd break it down into, you know, 2 to 5 steps that if you do those, then you're setting yourself up for success. So we really just want to focus on how do you get your mindset shifted into being more inclusive and into being more of an ally.
The first of the two is sort of that discipline of challenging the status quo. And the reason that I think we're using a word like discipline is that it isn't easy, but it's very required. And you kind of need to look at almost everything around you on an ongoing basis and ask if it works. Like, does this set of stairs work for the people who probably can't use stairs? Does this, you know, meeting setup work for someone who needs special needs? Does this insurance plan work for someone who wants to have a child that is not female? Like, you know, those kind of things on an ongoing basis where you look at stuff, you take yourself out of your own understanding of the world, look at it from someone else's perspective and ask if it works in an inclusive way, right? And I like to think of it as well as, you know, unlearning the status quo. We talked about at the start of this podcast that our quest was unlearning. Like, what do I know to be true today, which perhaps isn't the case? Like, how can I unlearn that without any pride and without any sort of ego, putting myself into someone else's shoes? So to me, that discipline of like, whatever you take for granted, whether it's mundane, it's the everyday access things that make your life work, ask, does it also make other people's life work? Is it inclusive? Is it truly bringing together the needs of multiple types of people?
Yeah, and I think it's such a good point, because I think sometimes, you know, apart from people being, you know, discriminatory or racist or bigots, I think it's important to recognize that systems are also discriminatory and racist and exclusionary, because we've just relied on, well, we've only ever hired from this school, or we only really hire MBAs, or we really strongly prefer people who live within a 5-mile radius of the office. Those are absolutely exclusionary policies. And, you know, so the difference between not being a racist and being anti-racist is exactly that, challenging the status quo. So it may not disadvantage you in any way, but are you able to say, well, why don't we start from scratch? Or let's take the bones of this, but now how do we make it more inclusive? And that's, you know, a good sort of segue into the second practice is really starting to exercise your inclusion muscle. And it's not about when you go to the DEI task force meeting. It's not about when you're making your annual plan or when you're about to hire somebody who is of color or a trans individual that maybe you haven't before. And, you know, now it's a very specific focus time. Exercise that muscle everywhere, you know? So think about even the most mundane things. So, you know, you think about Monday, you walk into the office, you go into, you know, a boardroom, everybody sits around the table, you know, somebody maybe starts a speech, hey, ladies and gentlemen, and then you go and talk about the week. Now break that down, right? What if, is that door wide enough to accommodate everybody? What if somebody's in a mobility device? When you go in, what if somebody, you know, doesn't identify as a lady or a gentleman? Is that, you know, is that inclusive? You know, just start to break down even the most mundane activities to find the nuggets of, and it's not, you know, nobody's gonna die on a sword to say, well, I need, dear ladies and gentlemen, to be the opening of every speech. No, nobody cares about it. But if you don't actively think about that, and if you don't actively exercise that muscle to think, hey, who am I leaving out? Then you're not building that muscle. And the beauty of exercising that muscle is that it will hold you in good stead right through your career. Nobody's ever going to say, oh, wow, Susan is just too inclusive. I'm really not a fan. You know, you'll find that it really correlates with positive, non-toxic workplaces, right? You're going to be a better manager. You're going to be a better friend. You're going to be a better parent. And so really exercising that muscle, it is, you know, the discipline and the exercising the inclusion muscle are such a perfect pair of activities that go together.
So wrapping up the allyship manual, we wanted to think about approaching inclusion and actions from the metaphor of baking. So in my sort of history in content, I spent a fair amount of time being a blogger, like, and food blogs, Rohini were my preferred tool. And often you would have to put in ingredients which might not work for everyone. So for example, if it's like a chocolate cake, like there might be someone who wants to make the chocolate cake who's vegan and therefore doesn't have egg, which is a pretty key thing, and butter, which is a pretty key thing in baking. So you usually have to provide an egg substitute, and you're like, you want one egg, use instead, you know, 3 tablespoons of flax and 6 tablespoons of water and leave it for 15 minutes. So really providing that knowledge translation so that more people can have access to that same body of work was something that came super naturally, I think, to recipe developers and bloggers and people in the food space, right? And they went quite far with it. Like, there's now stuff. I mean, at one point, as someone who's a mom to a kid who sort of had food allergies, it was difficult to find different things to suit diets. But now we've come a long way making sure that that sort of thing is possible. And I really want for us to think about inclusion. And again, maybe I'm oversimplifying it, but I'm eternally hopeful. I think we've gone through some seriously life-changing bonding experiences by the way of a pandemic. And it's possible, folks. I believe it's possible. I believe it's possible to approach it like that. And yeah, that's my little soapbox moment.
Absolutely. And I think when you break it down, I mean, so I think one sort of mindset shift or flip that I think is important is, let's say you're in a situation where somebody points out to you that you misgendered them, or you made you voiced a preconceived notion based on their identity, whatever that may be, race, gender, you know, sexuality. It is very important in that moment. I mean, the instinct, let's go with instinct. Instinct is to immediately defend yourself, right? Mm-hmm. So it is, I didn't do that. I didn't mean that. I would never. That's not my intention. Don't go there. Because what that person did in that moment is share their truth, right? And it takes courage to say, hey, what you're doing is hurting me, right? The person could ignore you. The person could retaliate. The person could be aggressive. But them taking a moment to say, hey, Rohini, what you said is inaccurate or actually hurts me or is not, you know, my gender identity. look at it as somebody asking for help and sharing their courage. If somebody, you know, if you were in a by a pool and somebody shouted from the pool, "Hey, I need some help," or "I may have got into the deep end by accident," your instinct is not to say, "Well, there are signs that are clearly everywhere," or "I don't care, I don't want to get wet." Your instinct is going to be to call a lifeguard, throw them afloat, or jump in, right? And so I think that's the important flip, is that when somebody points something out to you, it's not about you in that moment. So it's not about who you know, who your friends are, what you've learned, you know, you've been on a panel. It is in that moment you've hurt them. So it is entirely about them. So just making that flip just takes the ego out of it and takes the prickle out of it. And it's really important.
Yeah. So just like really remembering that in moments like this, it's not you, it's me. Like, it really, you're the one that needs to sort of rise up to the moment and make that more than words, and sort of like respect the fact that someone brought it in. So respecting that courage instead of giving in to that egocentric way of focusing on your own defense, I think, is really important. And once again, to sort of like go back, I guess, to that replacement in baking metaphor, it's just training yourself for that discipline, whether or not you need the special needs thing in the baking. Sometimes it's fun to check it out. It's like, oh, what happens to this egg if I replace it with flaxseed? Will my cake still be the same? You know what? Guess what? As someone who's tried it, I'm telling you, your cake will be exactly the same. So really thinking about it and replacing language, like clearly thinking about that articulation, like words have power, actions have power. And if you take away the ego, like if there's literally one thing you want to remove, it's like remove that ego and be open to hearing what someone's saying beyond just defending.
Yeah. And then I think the last thing is just don't be a sheep. It's very easy to put your head down and say, this is the way things are. I'm just a cog in the wheel. You know, what's my voice going to do? If you have any level of privilege, you have a voice that can affect change. It might be repetitive. It might mean many of you need to rise up and say something, but you have the power. So just don't be a sheep and say something.
Yeah.
Thank you for listening. And we hope you will continue to stay with us on this journey towards allyship.
If you like what you're hearing, don't forget to hit subscribe and please drop us a review. If you want to learn more about us or the ABCDEI podcast, visit abcdei.ca.